What's going down, Chris?
Yo, you played the right joint right there.
That was the right joint, wasn't it?
That was it. Out of here? Yo, dudes, don't be thinking about that.
No, they don't even know what you got in the arsenal, man. You got a 100-round clip of shit, man.
You know what it is.
You really do, man. I was just talking to somebody the other day, and they was like, man, that dude right there is the blueprint, man. No, you know what I mean?
Respect to that.
Straight up, man. You are, I'm talking about, and I mean from, ladies and gentlemen, first let me introduce y'all to the Blastmaster, a.k.a. KRS-One, the teacher, the god of all gods, man. You know what I'm saying? KRS-One.
We in the house.
Man, you looking good, my brother. You looking, and that book you gave me, man, if y'all don't have KRS-One's book, you can't say you love hip-hop or if you in hip-hop if you don't have the Bible.
Word. Gospel of hip-hop, man. It took us 14 years to write that. And
14 years.
It's really for the generation today. It's actually for hip-hopers that we knew that were going to come later.
It is.
Yeah, the kids, man.
14 days. So tell me why it took 14 years to write it.
Well, because when you're writing a philosophical book, like the book deals with philosophy, spirituality, you know, this, as a matter of fact, I should talk up here, right? This is my camera. I can see you.
I can see good. You. And they can hear you, brother. Right, you.
I want to be talking to you like this.
From the like the Jerry Curl box, right. You know what I mean? The smooth Jerry Curl box.
No doubt. So look, I mean, look, when you're writing philosophical work, it's not so much that you could write it and not be part of it. You have to experience everything you're writing about. It's not a novel. It's not even a biography. It's something that you're educating other people to consider. So you have to live it yourself. You have to experience what it is you're advising other people to do. So it took 14 years because everything we wrote, we had to experience it. And so it took that moment. And it would have took longer. I just cut it off and just said, this is coming out. It came out in 2009.
Hey, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, man. You know, because it's funny you said that, because the book, when you read it, it is a journey. It feels like a journey as you read it, you know. And I'm a slow reader. I haven't gotten through it. Like, I'm not gonna act like I really just read the whole book straight through. You know, that quick.
Come on, man.
You just gave it to me, but I browsed
pages.
I browsed through it, man. But it's such a pleasure to have you, man. And you know, you hip hop history, man. You know how jazz has a history. Every genre has a history. You are a hip hop history. And what you think, KRS-One, when you see the state of where hip hop is now, coming from where you came, from where you seen it at before you got started, because you started in the Bronx, you seen some shit that did nobody seen.
No doubt.
As a kid.
No doubt. Well, I tell you this, you know, it's gonna sound crazy to you.
Yeah.
Or really crazy to any of us that remember the original. But we kind of knew that this is what was going to go down. I used to say years ago, like in the 90s, early 90s, like 92.
You did,
About around 92. And I used to say all the time that our children are going to grow up and do another kind of hip hop. They're not going to want to do what we're doing. They're going to come up with something. Your head against the wall. So we as adults, we gonna look at that and say, y'all crazy. You gonna beat your head against the wall and make a beat?
And that's how did you see that? How did you see that though? What made you see that?
Because we was looking at how James Brown and how James Brown was always down with hip hop. But like let's say for instance, I'm trying to think of this band, Larry, who was this guy that battled Run DMC? She's strange.
Oh yeah,
I like it.
Yeah, Cameo.
People like Cameo. A lot of the jazz bands as well. they were looking at early hip hop like this was crazy. They kept saying every year, every 3 years, y'all gonna be out. They said in 3 years, this is gonna be over. This is gonna be over. And this is
they've been betting on you.
So I was looking at how they were coming at us, and I understood it. Look, we're dealing with Earth, Wind, and when hip hop first came out, the idea of sampling records and cutting and scratching records to a band like Earth, Wind, and Fire, that must have looked like complete stupidity.
Never looked like, at it that way. Never looked at it that way. Yeah.
They looking at it like these dudes is really playing, laying down keys. Here we come. We pick up that album, put it on the turntable, and start cutting the breaks. And we're saying, we are artists. This is a new art. This is how we going to do it for the next 50 years.
Yeah.
So imagine groups that were really laying it down in the studio, took hours to lay down just a drum sound.
Y'all come along.
And we come along sampling. And making more money.
Damn.
And making more money.
more money.
So you look at that, and then I saw then, I said, wow, look at how they coming at us. Remember Stetson Sonic made a record called Talking All That Jazz. Which was like a rebuttal. It was like hip-hop's rebuttal to the criticism that it was getting. But I looked ahead into the future, and I saw that our children we're going to do the same exact thing. And we were going to be the ones saying, that ain't no real.
Yeah, because you know what? It's crazy that you said that, KRS-One, because there's like genres of young rappers that I can match if I wanted to match them up, because I seen you guys. There's some young guys that I can match up that's coming from like, they babies of you. You know what I mean? Okay. They don't even know it. It's like a ginger of certain type of guys who are conscious. Now, this is a real question I've been wanting to ask for a long time, because a lot of people don't know that. And I don't know if I should say this. You started off as a gangster rapper? No.
Oh, yes.
You was a gangster rapper.
Oh, no doubt.
He was a gangster rapper.
I need to go get my first album. I've got to be somewhere around
then
here.
Show it to us. I know you're in the cave, man. Show us something good.
I tell you, it wasn't called gangster rap then. You know, the title gangster rap came from C. Dolores Tucker. She was trying to sue Warner Brothers.
Is that right?
Yeah, she's the one that labeled what we were doing gangster rap. It was actually called reality rap, was the original of it. And you'll notice NWA on their very first record, their first single was called Express Yourself, which was a conscious record. Mm. And the flip side had some other craziness on it, but their single was Express Yourself. And I say this to say that the original gangster rapper was a conscious rapper. That was the dude in the hood that was in the side, you know, all the 5%ers.
So what made, but y'all did have some clip. Y'all did have Uzi.
Yo, we learned that from the
Black. Y'all was with the shit though, man. Y'all was with the shit, KRS-One.
Yo, we learned that from the Black Panthers. Real talk. After the 60s, when the Black Panthers went crazy, and FBI infiltration, everybody really left from the Black Panther side. Even if you was a Panther, you started a gang. And it was clear that revolution requires the gangsters. Real revolution requires dudes that are gonna do the other shit. They're gonna do that other shit. And remember, when it comes to revolution, all revolutions from as far back as we can remember, it's the drug dealers, the dudes with the guns, the dudes that don't mind popping one of these racist pigs.
Yeah.
This dude, is the one that's the revolutionary. Mm. But look at Malcolm, okay?
It was positions, huh?
That's what I'm saying. Right. So it's like when the media, when not the media, but the corporate record companies, when they started seeing that we was getting money doing conscious records, like
they wanted to put a label on it.
They wanted to put, they really tried to destroy it. Remember, the corporate media loves what is we now call gangster rap. What they don't like is people like me.
Yeah, because you know, you definitely was put here to do a job. You know what I'm saying? You was put on earth to do a job and to and to share a certain required knowledge.
Our people need a friend and teacher was a guy named Kwame Ture.
Kwame Ture, I heard of him.
Kwame Ture, formerly known as Stokely Carmichael.
Stokely Carmichael, yeah.
Well, this was my good buddy. This was my friend. He was an older man. He took me in. I joined this organization called the All African People's Revolutionary Party. I learned about Kwame Nkrumah.
Now, was this after your best friend was killed, or this was before? This was after.
This was all after. But keep in mind, though, I always knew what time it was, even when I was with Scott Wright, even when we put Criminal Minded out.
You were still there.
All through Criminal Minded, I'm called the teacher. Mm. All through Criminal Minded, I'm like, yo, this is the teacher. We're going to learn. We're going to get this. And if you listen to South Bronx, who was just running before we got on, South Bronx, that's a history lesson. In fact, the African American Museum in Washington, D.C. confirmed that that was the first recorded history of hip hop ever, was the record South Bronx.
South Bronx.
And it's so funny. So let me correct myself right here, right now, for the story.
South Bronx.
That hip hop did not start in the South Bronx. It actually started in the West Bronx with Cool DJ Herc. And
the
I lived
West
there
Bronx.
Too. The West Bronx was 1520 Sedgwick Avenue in the Bronx.
Yeah. How did the word get over there that it was the South Bronx then?
Because I said it.
You put it out there for a whole new generation.
The South Bronx is where I was living at the time.
Yeah.
And I was in Millbrook Projects. That's where I was. 132nd Street, Millbrook Projects. Woo! We was up in there. So that's like the whole South Bronx down there. So I was writing just for my little crew right there in a battle mode, this kind of thing. I didn't know years later it would be in a museum, the African American Museum in the hip hop section.
Oh, yeah. Come on, man. That's real history, man. Any youngster that's in the rap game, man, definitely need to listen to that, man, and understand the whole genre of that, man. That's why I wanted to get with you guys, man, and do this show, KRS-One, because I always knew that hip-hop, like I was telling Dougie Fresh, I said, man, hip-hop, it rides under everything. You got athletic hip-hop, you got comedy hip-hop. I would consider myself a comedic hip-hop.
You are hip-hop.
You know what I mean?
You?
I'm hip-hop.
Out of all comedians, you.
Oh, man. Because I've been such a learner to it. And see, people don't understand. See, I'm from Indiana, man, right? And for so many years, I mean, I go to big cities, man, especially New York City, man. I respected New York so much, man, and I really wanted to understand what the culture was that I moved to New York. Mm. You know, I moved to New York because I wanted to be challenged in my craft, because I wasn't challenged in my craft in Indiana or even on the West Coast in Hollywood. It just wasn't when you went to New York, man, I mean, that was the first place that I went to that, you know, you spoke to somebody and they didn't speak back. They thought something was wrong with you. You spoke to them.
Right. Good morning. What the fuck wrong with you?
Yeah, well, I was looking at you like, what the fuck you talking about? I was like, man. But, you know, after I called my mother and told me, Mama, there's some rude motherfuckers up here. Guess what? After a couple years, it made my skin tough. And it taught me about life. I was like, you know what? this shit that y'all down there stressed out about in Ohio and Kentucky and all that shit, these people is walking through this shit.
Right.
The kids, hey, let me tell you something, Karis. Well, I ain't never seen a bunch of grown motherfucking kids like New York City. Them are some grown.
Those are grown kids.
Them little motherfuckers. Hey, man, they 20 years old when they 10, man.
Oh, yeah. You won't survive in New York if you're not. Yo, I was riding the trains in New York at 6.
Damn.
I was 6 years old. I
used on to the 6th train, huh?
No, actually, the D train.
The D train, huh?
The D train. I'm six years old. Taking the whole trains, the buses, and no cell phones. We had 10. You had to put 10 cents in a pay phone.
In the phone booth.
Mom, I'm good. Yo, what it is? Imagine. We can't even live without a cell phone today. And our children, like, imagine your kid go out. They got the phone.
They
can hit you. You can hit them. Imagine the 80s, even the 90s, a little bit of the 90s.
Come on, speak on it, man.
Before the cell phone, when kids went out, when you left your house, you were gone. You were gone. When you left your house, he was gone. And there's something that people forgot, too. That when you went outside, when you was young, you went outside on your own block. You could walk all the way down to the front of your block and stay. Your mother say, stay on this block. So you stay on the block you playing. Everybody knew their mother's voice. Their mother would stick their head out the window and say, Larry, get in here. Everybody knew, yo, that's your mother right there.
Out of them apartment buildings.
Out the projects, dudes knew what it was, and you would go.
I love it, man. And I love it.
And somebody else's moms will scream. And they'd be like, yo, that's Johnny's mom's over there.
Crazy, man. You seen that shit, man, and you standing there, man, skin glowing, still knowledgeable, still young and energized. Like, when I seen you perform at that party, man, the first thing I thought about, I said, man, that dude right there, he's like Minister Farrakhan and them. He preserved himself for the generations, man.
Yo, the spirit will do it.
Saved yourself for us, man.
Look, I all praises due to God.
And your beautiful wife. Don't forget about your beautiful wife.
How can I? Simone all day.
We gotta give our wife, you know who's behind this shit, really.
You know what it is. You know what it is. And that's real, too. That's real. Women need to rise up right now and feel that. You know what I'm saying? Behind every great man.
Let me tell you something, man. They put that glow on us, man. And you know what? You could tell when a man got a good woman behind him. And you could tell when a man is out there by himself. You know, it's a whole different position, you know?
Wow. You need that again. Wow.
Yeah. Because I've been both of them, man. I've been a gigolo and I've been married. So, hey, man.
You got wisdom.
That's right. Hey, you gotta deal with a few things, man, to have that glow. You know, you gotta be strong. You gotta be patient. You gotta give. You gotta give what a lot of men fight to give to a woman, man, to get that glow. You don't get that glow for free.
Right. Oh, now you get. Woo, I thought you was gonna go somewhere else with it. Like, no, you don't get that for free. It is a cost.
That's right. It costs you. It's a great cost too. It's a great one.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, KRS-One, man, it's a pleasure to talk to you, man. Now, just speaking, man, now, I know the fans and the artists, you got fans all over the world. Could you tell everybody a little bit about, could you tell us your first, what was your first world tour that you ever did, the first country that you left to go to, and what song was it that sent you all over the world? Your first song.
Well, believe it or not, my first song was South Bronx, the first hit song.
That sent you overseas?
No. That just sent me up the block to the corner store. That was just a two block success.
Two
block success, and then The Bridge Is Over was like another two blocks, four blocks. By the time we get the Criminal Minded, which is the album 1987. The first place I went to was Philadelphia, believe it or not.
Wow.
The Philly, big up to Lady B, too, by the way.
Lady B, shout out to Lady B.
No doubt. Philadelphia was one of the first places we used to go to out of New York to get it started. So I really didn't leave America, so to speak, until, say, about 1989 with ghetto music. This is after, this is...
ghetto music.
Yeah, the ghetto music, the blueprint of hip-hop. You have Criminal Minded, then I followed up with By All Means Necessary, and then it was Ghetto Music. And by the time I get to Ghetto Music, that's three albums. Now I get my first call for England, actually, and it was a tour. It was only me on the tour.
Damn!
It was only me on the tour, and I picked up this two young female MC groups. One was called the Wee Papa Girls.
Wee
Papa Girls. And this other obscure MC, her name was Dana. She called herself Queen Latifah.
I took her with me. Wow.
I took her with me.
Yeah.
And we went out on the tour. We went out on England. Kind
shout,
of like
out to, shout out to Queen Latifah, man. Shout out to the Queen great Latifah Queen Latifah. That's woo. And you guys match up really well, too, man. I like that.
Come on, Dana's my sister, no doubt.
Oh, beautiful woman, yeah.
And she had to pick the mic up and get busy. And so that was my first real tour. And you know, you learn so much. I must have spent, I can't even think of the money I spent on ignorance. Okay?
Yeah.
On ignorance.
You was fly, though. You was fly for the time. Hey, you had some of the meanest leathers. That leather jacket, that black with the white on it. Woo!
Wait a minute, that's different. No, that's different. I'm talking about when you travel overseas, and let's say the whole tour is worth, say, 500, say 300,000. The whole tour is worth 300,000. Okay.
Yeah.
You land in England. Okay, Heathrow Airport. The limo's costing you. Three dudes as assistants costing you. The tour bus killing you. Hotels killing you. I spent tens of thousands, okay, before I realized, and it's like 10 years later, I realized, wait a minute, I could drive in England. Hold up. I don't need this limo. I could go to Hertz Rental, rent me a car, and drive myself.
Why do you think you was doing that? Did you like the camaraderie? And it's like you was paying for the backstage party and the support and the people to talk to. It was like that little, you know.
Well, I tell you, I was told that this is the way it was supposed to be.
Right.
And everybody around me was the same way. I mean, every act was the same way. Limo, tour bus, security. Road management, da, da, da. And it costs.
DJ.
Come on, the wardrobe, everything. It costs. So I got to a point because I realized that what the audience really wanted to see was me and these rhymes. So I was like, wait a minute. I got backdrops. I got lighting. I brought my own lighting guy. I have a chef. Yo, we get the bill at the end of the tour.
He said, I have a chef.
I'm eating good, G.
You was balling. Yeah.
But then you get the bill at the end of the tour. And they said, I said, look, I'm supposed to make 300 grand on this tour with my money. They said, yo, you in the hole, 100 grand.
100 grand.
The tour cost 400.
Yeah.
You only made three. You ate that up in tour buses and stuff. So what? I'm going home with nothing and I owe money?
Ooh.
I was like, nah.
That was a valuable lesson, huh?
But you learn. And what it is I learned. And, you know, you talk about strong women in your life. Well, that's when Simone lifted up and said, look, I'm going to book the world tours myself. So we ain't got to deal with these agents. We ain't got to deal with all this. Yeah. So me and Simone, and actually the kids, my three kids, Chris, Isaac, and Ty.
Yeah, shout out to the kids and Simone, man. Shout out to the engine, man.
We went on the road. I taught my kids how to sell. They was like 10 years old. I had them making 4-5 G's a night. Okay.
Yeah.
Like 10 years old. They on the road with me. They on the road with their father. They selling
that's
the shirts.
Beautiful,
and the
man.
CDs.
That's beautiful, man.
They selling the shirts and the CDs. So I learned, I was like, yo, it's better to put your family on than these clowns that you got around you. Now,
that's
if you're privileged to do that, you know, everybody
that's right.
can work with their family like
that's
that.
That's right. That's
but
right.
But if you can, you know what I'm saying?
That's
bring
right.
your kids, put your kids on tour. Let them learn how to manage, do sound, do lights, sell merchandise. Kids love it. They love it. They
dealing with the people and yeah.
The people, all of this, they love it.
It teaches them how to be businessmen and women.
Well, you know, that's what it is. Look, as a father, that's exactly what I wanted my daughter specifically to know. How to get her money.
Yeah.
And my sons are good. They know what it is. But I got one girl, my one little girl. So I'm like, yo, you got to learn how to get your cash.
Yes.
And she cut her teeth right there.
Yeah.
On selling. Also, we went through Europe. We all up in Australia. This is out.
Hey,
okay?
Let me tell you something, man. You inspiring everybody on here right now. If you listening to this, we on here with the Blastmaster KRS-One. Listen, keep your ear open, keep your knowledge open. The man is giving us jewels. He's teaching us how to raise our families, be with our families. He's teaching us. Now we want to keep on going because there's so many questions I want to ask you. I know I only got a little bit of time with you, but this one question that I've been wanting to ask, man, everybody been wanting to ask, as far as the music business is concerned, like, how do you judge battle rapping? You know, what is battle rapping to you, man? What is battle rapping? Because now they have a whole nother different style of battle. Battle rapping did change 3-4 different ways, didn't it?
It has. The rules, look, what I'm noticing is that the rules are still pretty much the same. Your rhymes still got to be right. You still got to come with the skill. But what I'm noticing is that dudes are spending more time on punchlines than rhythm and syllables. Damn. You know, you say certain words that could become sentences or this kind of thing. They're not really spending much time on the intricacies of wordplay and poetry. They're just trying to insult the next guy, which is fine. If you're in a battle, that's what a battle is. I'm going to take you out right
now
with this shit right here.
Yeah.
But the other side to it is that, but show me your skill too. Like, and MCs that battle should know this. Even if you lose a battle, if you show skill, you still won.
They still love it.
You still got your crew. If you show the skill, you know, they'll say, well, damn, he lost the battle. But that, what he did right there, yo, that I'm gonna take that for myself. I'm gonna go and do that.
You remember that feeling in them clubs, man, going crazy and walking out
with
sweating.
Me now. Yo, I brought it to your show. That show we did the other day.
You
that
killed
was Latin
it.
Quarters.
You killed it.
That was Latin Quarters right there. That was it. You had Dougie, Rakim, Kane. Yo, we
Greg
didn't even
Knight.
See each. Dude, we ain't even see each other, okay, in a year.
That's
okay.
Crazy. Yeah.
I'm running up on my brothers like, yo, it was a dope reunion. Yo, and I don't want to be rude or crass here, but everybody, you got to go see this show. And I'm not just saying it. You know, I'm not just saying this. I'm saying it for real, for real. If you really want to see what it really is. Yeah!
Hold up, I gotta get the thing.
Rewind!
Hey, they don't know nothing about that, man. What year was this?
1997.
Yo,
you So I look behind me. I had shit exploding.
Hey, we had to give it to KRS-One, man. The great KRS-One. Hey, man, yo. you didn't drop some songs, man. And let me tell you something. You have been so ahead of time, man, as an artist, as a black man. I mean, you've been talking about this police brutality, man, before a lot of people was even born, man. And for you to still be here, was that a new song you did?
Yes. I blazed you exclusively.
Oh,
it's from a new album I'm doing called Between the Protest. Between the Protest, BDP.
And when I tell you, you were speaking on right now. I'm talking about, hey, y'all, KRS-One got a new song coming out. And it's on the lines of all of the old joints you heard, but it's new.
Yes.
Okay? Smell like brand new money.
No doubt. I had to get that out. And you gave me the platform. I had to say it right there. The song is called Murder We Just Saw. And it's talking about what we seeing, like, you know, the murder we just saw.
Yeah, you was doing the song like this song right here.
On the mic and premieres on the brains.
Hey, hey, hey. Oh, you need to stop right now. Oh, you can't do this.
What year was that?
1995.
Ooh. Up my arm, because I'm like, man, that's KRS. Look, dude, you are considered like, hey, I mean, I don't know no homo, as y'all would say in New York, but hey, you know what I mean? I bow down, man. Homage to you, God.
I'm on the floor with you. I'm bowing. Yo, there's no me without you and everybody else that's watching.
That's the sound that I'm putting in. That's the sound that I'm bees. That's the sound that I'm putting in.
Yeah.
You take a word like officer and twist it over to overseer. It's that kind of lyrical intricacy that I'm not hearing today.
Everybody don't have that mind, man. You know, that's the genius in you. Speaking of that, man, when did you become a doctor, man? What year did you become doctrinated into the teaching and the learnings and learning more and stuff, and it wasn't just hip hop. What year did you transform?
Wow, you know, first of all, the direct answer is 1989, Yale University. A guy named Master Theodore. Big up to Theodore over in Yale.
Master Theodore.
People know Master Theodore.
Master Theodore.
He was big in philosophy and history and heard me. He heard what I was doing as well. And he called me to Yale. It was my first lecture ever.
Wow.
In a university. So I went to Yale. I did my lecture. I had my man with me too. REM, Michael Stipe was with me.
Okay.
Came out as well. We went up there and I just crushed them. I put a thing out called, at the time it was Emancipation Procrastination.
Procrastination.
And I was arguing that the Emancipation Proclamation never really freed the slaves, never really freed Africans. It freed the Southern slaves in Southern states. There was an armed rebellion. And I remember saying that to them, and they was really like scratching their head. They didn't really know what it was. But later on, other historians pulled the same file and said, if you really read what Abraham Lincoln said, he didn't free no Northern slaves. He freed the Southern slaves. It was the slaves in armed rebellion. So anyway,
Long
story short.
Yeah, that wasn't specific in the books. Huh?
That was, you know, so as we go on, I'm doing more and more lectures. I pick up a few honorary degrees as well. When you say doctor, I got like three honorary doctorates.
Honorary doctrines.
Of universities, one overseas as well. So it's like, it's been an ongoing thing with me. I mentioned 89 Yale because that's my first lecture. But as you can see, from 89 to now, okay,
yes.
Right now, I'm still lecturing right now.
I think your voice is so underrated in America, man.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I have to say that in my opinion,
yes.
Is because you're the truth.
Look, the truth can't be out there like that. And you got to accept that at the very beginning. Look, when I was younger, I used to get pissed off because I said, here we did the Stop the Violence movement, self-destruction. We got everybody on the record. This is it. BET don't want to play the record. The radio don't want to play the record. Nobody want to play the record. And it's like, it used to aggravate me like, yo, what's up? We trying to do something. What's up? But then I realized you're going to have to drink this bitter cup right here. You're not going to get the Grammy. You're not going to get the awards. You ain't gonna call you for the big tour.
Your awards, I mean, them people that get them awards ain't finna get the one you get either.
Oh, you know, I'm sitting with
that
the
one
award.
You get. That you know with the one you get, that one
and
you
I
get.
I enjoy, dude. I'm in Atlanta.
It's ancestrally
right?
Given, man. You know the ancestors give you yours.
You need to say that again. Ancestral. You already know that's
ancestral, man. You know what I'm saying?
That's the true award.
And you stuck to your guns. Nobody never seen you say, you know what? I ain't getting what I want. I'm a bend and fall over that way. You know.
Word.
And that's a true testament, man. And definitely, man, what the kids need to see, man. You know what I mean?
You know. And let me tell you,
you've been the same way all the way through.
The kids see it. They see it. They walk up on me all the time. Dude, I can't go nowhere. I can't shop. I can't go nowhere.
Yeah, because okay?
I was on lockdown before COVID, my kid. Okay? I walk outside, and I tell you, my kids, they know as well. We go outside, they say, Dad, stay in the car. we'll go get whatever we got to go get.
How do you deal with people that challenge you intellectually, man, because you're a black man? You know what I mean? How do you deal with that?
Well, when you're the truth, you have to have patience with people that don't really know. I only speak from what I know. If I don't know something, I'll tell you. I don't know. You know, straight up.
Just straight black and white. You black and white.
I'd say, but if I know something, then I'm not going to front and try to bite my tongue in it. No, if I know something, I'm going to tell you, look, this is what it is, G.
Yeah.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Now, if you don't agree, you don't agree. Okay, that's it. But I told you.
Yeah.
So this is what it was in the 90s. I told him, love's going to get you.
Okay? Yeah.
When you
love's
going to
get
love,
you.
Love's going to get you. When you fall in love with all this bullshit material shit, hey, it's going to catch up.
It's going to get you, man. And you know what? That's what COVID-19 did. COVID-19 showed everybody that you didn't need none of this shit.
Word. Wow. You just dropped a jewel right there.
All you learned that all you needed was what you did. It was some simple shit because simple. Nothing mattered. You know what I mean? And you know, it still don't.
Rappers are figuring it out right now. Everybody sitting home.
Everybody.
Not just rappers. I can't even front. The whole music industry.
That's right.
It's sitting home.
Hey, yo, we gonna go to the grocery store in that Lambo?
We are discovering the grocery store now. We are discovering the restaurant up the block now. We are discovering.
Hey, man. I'm talking about people have been so humble, man, from this time, man. Now, I got to ask you. I don't want to hold you no longer, man. We got this big party coming up October the 9th. The Grand Blastmaster KRS-One, Rakim, Big Daddy Kane, Dougie Fresh. We got to ask you one more time. I got to ask you one more thing because we need to know, man. What is our status when it comes to voting, man? What is our status when it comes to the police as black men? What is our status as black women and black men in this country right now? We want to hear from Blastmaster KRS-One, man. What is our status, man? What do we do? How do we approach this, man, as being black men with the police and voting? And because we under so much pressure, man.
Yep.
We pressure from so many different directions to do this and do that. They got vaccines coming. All this stuff is flying towards us, man.
Yep.
Give us something that can anchor us, man. You know, as for young black men out here, man, and black women, and all ethnicities right now that's going through something, man. What do you think about today's times, man?
Yo, I tell you, man, what a timely question. And of course, you know, we don't even have time to talk. Really? This is like a 2 hour. This is a 3 hour just on this question.
I can dig
right
it.
Here.
Yeah.
I'll say this though. I'll say this, and I appreciate the question too, because for those listening, you know, the hardest thing to realize, black people first. I'm talking to black people first right now. The hardest thing for us to realize as a people is that we are the gods of this earth.
Mm-hmm.
This is what we pray to God. We become Muslim, Buddha, Christian, Jewish, everything except ourselves.
Mm.
And all of these religions, all of them were...
Say that again, except ourselves.
Except us. The reason we are in the United States right now is because they stole our religion, our sense of government, everything. And guess what? Not only did they steal it, the true kings gave it away and said, you know what? We as black men and women, really, to be honest with you, it was the woman that set this up. It was the black queen is called the Kandake and in Africa. And the Kandake, the black king, is called the Negus. Negus Nagas, King of Kings, Lord of Lords.
Negus Nagas, not Negus. I know y'all think he said Nagas.
No, wait a minute. Yo, you're going to get me stretched out because, because that's where this word, because the word nigger, N-I-G-E-R, not Niger or Niger, none of that makes any sense. That has no etymological significance.
So is that a correct spelling of that word, double G?
Yes, the correct spelling of the word nigger is N-I-G-E-R, not two G's, one
G-E-R.
Yes, N-I-G-E-R is the original spelling of the word nigger.
They put two G's on it.
They put two G's on it to degrade the one G.
Oh, man.
Okay, they put two G's to degrade the one. What they're calling us is a degradation, but the word itself is not a degradation. In fact, the original niggas are teachers and prophets. The original niggas, N-I-G-E-R. Matter of fact, because I'm going to...
Wow, come on with it, man.
But I'll say this to you for the people listening. Go to Acts 13 in the Bible. Go and grab your Bible. Go to Acts 13 in the Bible. In Acts 13, you'll see the only time the word nigger is mentioned, N-I-G-E-R, it's mentioned in a story of how the first church was built. All theologians know this. The very first church ever built, the Christian church ever built, was in Antioch, in the region of Antioch, Syria, out there. This was all black folk out there, the original Syria, all black folk.
The first church,
not the second, not the third, not
first
the
ever.
The first church, the first Christian church is in Antioch. And the ones who established it were niggers, N-I-G-E-R-S, niggers. Go to your...
And it wasn't called Eastside Baptist either, was it?
It wasn't none of that. It was called nigger. Okay? And so you go there and you look. Now, there's a bunch more to deal with that because the etymology of the word nigger is really Ethiopian. What they're saying, when you look at the word nigger, they'll say commonly called the Ethiopian, known as the Ethiopian. So when you say nigger, you're really referring to the Ethiopian, the ancient Ethiopians who were astronomers, architects, agriculturalists. It's this white dude, this racist, that's degrading our names. And because we believe in this dude so much, we say, oh man, we shouldn't use the word nigger. We shouldn't use the word nigger. Nah, you should always use the word nigger because that is the word that defeated them. That's what, imagine a colonist, which is what they are, imperialists and colonists. They coming in your land to steal your stuff. That's their only purpose, okay? So they go there and they say, who's the king? They say, the nigger, right here. And some call us the nigger, the nega, the naga, and the negus. All of these are the same words.
Naga.
They say, yo, that's the nigger, the king, right there. You go try to diss the king by saying, oh, nigger. Like, you're going to degrade. It's sort of like saying...
That's deep. I get it.
It's sort of like saying Michael Jordan. And then you say Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan's one of the greatest athletes on the planet, okay?
So it's all about, that word is so powerfully disrespectful in this country because
white folks are degrading it.
It's the emotion behind it and the real true feeling about the word.
Because white folk are saying nigga while they hating us, we don't want to use the word, but what we got to understand is that the very word nigger, N-I-G-E-R, that word means king. That was our word. So imagine if China was to invade America, the first thing they would say is president is a derogatory term. Anybody calling themselves a president
is derogatory.
You let 3-4 generations go by of you being taught in school, president is a racial epithet. President is not what you want to say. Don't say president. You let some generations go by. After a while, you don't even want to say president anymore, even though Barack Obama is our first African-American president. So it's this white, colonial, racist, actually institutional racism. That's making us hate ourselves. And this is what self-hate is. You would think, somebody say, if you say the word nigger, you're hating yourself, you're degrading yourself. Nah, if you're not saying the word nigger, you're degrading yourself. Because the reason the word nigger is offensive is only because the white racist made it that way. We never said the word nigger was offensive for 100,000 years.
Yeah, most of us don't even know where the word, most of us think they made the word up.
No, they didn't. That's an African word. Wow. Nigger. That's an African word. And it's associated with the river, actually, with rivers and river people. The beginnings of civilization, basically.
Uh-huh.
But forget that. You get me off into something else. Let me come back to your question.
Hey, Let me go ahead. I don't want to break you up.
what you saying?
No, I don't want to break you up. I don't want to break you up because you want to, I got to let you get that out. Go ahead. And finish all right. That.
I'll just say this on this other side, that the condition of us today.
Yeah.
I always argue that we need to go from civil rights to civilization rights. Our parents...
Say that again. We need to go from
civil rights...
Civil rights.
The victory of our the victory of our parents is civil rights. They won that battle. Big up to the whole crew. Dr. King, Malcolm, Marcus even. Marcus Garvey. I'll go back far to that.
Marcus Garvey. Yeah, Garveyites.
Kwame Ture, big up. Our parents did they think, some of you, your grandparents, great-grandparents, they fought that fight for civil rights, and they won. Imagine poor people. We, those who are awake, are going to say, wait a minute. What else are we supposed to do? We got the civil rights. What else do we need? Well, the answer is, let us restore what was stolen from us. Damn. What was stolen? Not goods, not land. Fuck these diamonds, gold. You can have that shit. If that's what y'all want, y'all can have that. Here's what we want. We want sovereignty. That's what we want.
Explain to the people what that means. What's sovereignty to the people?
Sovereignty is self-governance. Sovereignty means you are independent and self-governing. It's not so much a thought. Like you first have to have
the thought. I understand, yeah.
Right, you have to have the thought first. But real sovereignty is, I got my farm, I got my military, I got my schools, I got my own hospitals, I got my own courts and jails. Okay,
so we're not allotted to have that.
No, we're not allowed to have that. There's two things you could say to the United States government that will show you who they are for real. Two things. One, give me sovereignty. Return my sovereignty to me. Secondly, after that, if you to the United States and to the world, if we are not recognized as a sovereign nation within this nation, like the Native Americans, right, we gone, okay? And we're going to put our resume on the table of Russia. We're going to put our resume on China's table. Do you know what these countries would do to have the African-American citizenship in their country? We are the most valuable group of people in the world.
Say it again.
We are the most valuable group of people in the world.
Black people in America.
If we went to Yemen, that's getting bombed right now by America, Britain, France.
And started us a country.
If we go to Yemen right now, okay, and say, you know what? We out of here, America. We're gone. You don't respect us. You ain't giving us no sovereignty. You shooting us in the street. Let's go to Iran. Okay, let the whole African America, the whole 14% of us, okay, we're gonna go to Iran. Iran's gonna recognize us as a sovereign nation within their nation. We're gonna follow their rules, we're gonna follow their laws, but you recognize that we sovereign over here, okay, and we're gonna build our sovereignty. Now, in exchange for that, here's what you get. The whole NBA is with you now. The whole football, national football, there is all the rappers, all
so
the
you can have everything, huh?
All the comedians, everybody is in Iran now, talking that Iranian shit, and leave America to its fucking self. This fucking country can't do shit without African Americans. Hey, they can't do nothing.
Hey, guess what? It'd be a whole lot of golfing. It'd be some golf on and some, yo, what else would be on? Golf and
everything. The whole yo, I'm just making, yo, listen to me, my G.
It'd be hockey games on all day, huh?
No, not even hockey. Not even hockey. You can't have nothing without African Americans. You can't, yo. Who do you think the essential workers are? Big up to Latino people right
Big
here.
Big up
right
to the
now.
Latinos, man. I love Latino people. I love white people too.
That's why I say, yo, I tell my Mexican brothers and sisters, I say, yo, why don't you tell America, you know what? We all going to leave. We all going to leave. And we're going to take our road building and our architecture and our cleaning techniques with us. Yes. You ain't gonna be able to call a Mexican for nothing.
You ain't.
Watch how this country turn they tune around. Oh, they'll turn
hey,
that. But here's the thing: we're not advocating that. We're not advocating, and it's not us as a people. Our intellectuals are cowards. That's the problem. Those who do know what I'm talking about are afraid to speak up.
Yeah, and well, now, you know what? Well, you know what? A lot of them are extorters. A lot of them is doing it for money. You know what I mean? They call them when the shit go down and got a check for them. You know what I mean?
And that's a shame though. That's a shame because that's all of Africa. Notice how I said Iran, Russia, China. Mm. I didn't say Africa. 90% of African leadership is corrupt and the whole world knows it.
Yeah.
The whole world knows it.
Yeah.
So African America, like imagine, we getting shot in the
street. It started over there.
This is why I say to people, they don't want to recognize this. People say, oh yeah, Africa. I love Africa too. You already know.
Yeah.
That's the motherland. Okay.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
But you just speaking
about the politics, the true politics.
The politics,
that's but everybody know that. You ain't saying no lie. You ain't saying nothing, don't nobody know.
The sovereignty of it. Now imagine we getting shot in the street here. African Americans are getting shot in the street. Why Nigeria ain't saying nothing? Why Ghana ain't saying nothing? Why Ethiopia and Egypt and these places? This is Africa. We African Americans. Why the South African government, Mandela and his whole crew, why they not saying nothing? Because they all down with this bullshit too. And African Americans are going to have to think about this. We need our own constitution, my G.
We do.
We
do
our own law.
What you saying, man, is so powerful and true. And I think, you know, KRS, I think that most of our, the lack of power, the most of the power that we lack, it comes from oblivion. It comes from being oblivious. We don't even know this shit, man.
We don't. Right.
We don't even know this stuff, man. You know, we're not citizens here, man. They borrow money on our social security number.
We ain't even citizens, G.
No.
And this brings me back to your voting question as well. Now, I urge everybody to get out there and vote. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm not a voter myself. Me,
yeah.
I'll tell you right now, I'm going to keep it really real with you.
Yeah.
I voted one time in my life. It was for Barack Obama. That was about it for me, okay? I can't take it.
Hey, man, I heard that, man.
So I urge everybody, if you a voter and if you into voting, and all of that, do your duty and urge everybody around you to go ahead and do that, no question.
Yeah.
But some of us are revolutionaries, and we already know that the voting is a joke, really. The money that's involved, and on top of that, the electoral college, where you're not really voting for a president, you're voting for a member of the electoral college who then votes for the president.
Dang.
So even if they say, say that again, man.
They say,
oh, your vote counts. It's your voice. That's bullshit.
It's a chain of command, huh?
And we at the bottom of that chain. Keep that in mind too, okay? So, like I was saying, it's the Electoral College. Just that alone, just that concept by itself. We're not voting for a president. You, when you put your vote in, you are not voting for the president. You're voting for a member, a representative of your state. That's who you vote. That's who you put the vote. And they take the votes and say, oh, okay, Hillary won the popular vote. Hillary won the election. But we, the Electoral College, are just going to give it to Trump.
Mm.
What vote matters then? What are you saying?
It's
all behind the door. Here's the thing though, but there's so much anger with this president right now amongst a majority of Americans that your vote might matter on this particular election.
No question.
If you could get a landslide victory, which is what the Democrats are hoping for. So even the Electoral College, the popular vote, the Supreme Court, all of these different entities that can affect the vote, or all of these entities, a landslide victory wipes them all out. This is the clear winner, and that's the end of it. Okay, that's it. Now, keep in mind, though, Let me keep it really real with my voters.
The fans is love the fan. I'm not to cut you off. The fans is loving it. They loving it. They going crazy. Keep
big up to everybody out there listening. Here's the realness right now. Okay, it's all white supremacy. The whole system. Okay. Anything you vote, you talk, you add, you
and you know what? It a lot. I mean, this 2020 has exposed it. It brought out a lot of shit.
If you can't see the white supremacy now, yo, Breonna Taylor, them dudes just got off. Yo, every African American in this country shouldn't be working. We shouldn't be doing nothing for this country. Nothing. All the black judges, the black lawyers, the black COs, the black doctors, the architects, the cookers, the rappers, and everybody else, we shouldn't be doing nothing. We should all go on strike.
How did our heritage gain a certain percentage in a group of black people who are totally different than what you're saying? Like it's black people that just think totally different. You like, damn. How could you be black and see this happening to us and still think like that?
The dude that got them cops off is a black man.
The black man.
Now this is what we got to do.
What is that about, though? What is that about?
It's called sellout. We always had them.
His ultimate goal. I try to think of guys like that. What the fuck is the ultimate goal? Because
his career.
They're not going to never, but they still don't accept you. Guys like that don't realize they will let you in for doing that coon shit, but you are still not in.
They're going to throw you away too. And at the end of the day, we fall for the same. Yo, this was going on the slave plantations. This was going on the plantation. Nat Turner was betrayed by a black man, by a black kid.
Okay. Watch them kids out there, y'all. Watch them teenagers.
Some teenager, okay, betrayed Nat Turner. So it's like if we don't first deal with our own selves, which we might not be able to deal with. There's too many coons, too many Toms, too many sellouts, too many traitors.
It is.
What you got to do, really. Really, is you got to take care of your family. That's the final frontier right there. And I'm not saying it as a cop out. I'm saying it as a political strategy.
Yeah, there's nothing else you can really do.
Take care of your family. Take care of your family. Educate your kids. Love your spouse. Take care of your family, because that's the only thing that's going to keep you intact. Is your group, your crew. And when I say family, not just your sons, daughters, or so, whoever you consider that intimate person with you, even friends and allies and people you got.
Take care of yours, huh?
Take care of yours and your people. Take care of them, because you could clearly see, my G, you can see the racism is so blatant. Dudes is not hiding it no more.
They're out in the open with it. Yeah, it is. It is. And then guys like you, Public Enemy, Ice Cube, guys like y'all been
America, speaking this. KKK.
They've been speaking, y'all been speaking this for years.
But this is what white supremacy is about. The black man can speak forever. It don't matter until white folk get angry. Now when white folk get angry and say, oh no, white folk wear the Black Lives Matter shirt now. Now Black Lives Matter. But when we was wearing the shirt 2, 3, 4, 5 years ago, it didn't matter. In fact, it was a statement that most of the white community didn't even like.
Yeah, that's why I've always been curious. I've always been curious about why do we have to bite our tongue about what we're going through, how we feel about guess what? We all can see what's happening to us, but they like, don't say nothing.
Right.
If you say something about you, like, why am I not to say anything about something that is in both of our space?
Right. Because
like, I'm wrong for that.
Yes. Yes. You are absolutely wrong. You're supposed to speak quiet while I rob you. Quiet while I rape you. quiet. Be quiet. Let me be the criminal that I am, and you say nothing. Be passive, black man, black woman. Be passive. That's why I say, look, I don't condone violence, man. I don't condone violence. We put something out called the Stop the Violence Movement, okay? Hip-hop ain't about all that, okay? We are clear with this.
Yeah.
Don't think for 1 minute you're going to put your hand in my pocket.
This young generation, woo, it's gonna be rough, man.
Oh, yo, and you know what? I'm gonna encourage the young generation. I'm gonna tell them straight up, look, here's the truth. The truth is, I cannot tell anyone to be violent. It's against my principles. But when you faced with somebody's pointing a gun.
Yeah, what do you do?
What the fuck? Like, what are you so and on top of that, somebody pointing a gun at you and you got your Glock in the small of your back too? And you got your crew with you? Now let's go get these dudes. Let's go get these dudes right now.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? But I tell you this, there's too many cowards out there. There's too many, and not our regular people, our workers and stuff. People got shit to lose.
But ones with the power.
The ones with the power. That's the real. Is this black people with?
Because they don't need the average everyday dollar. They should be fighting hard.
Right. Right.
But the guy that needs the everyday dollar, he gotta play the game and come home.
He dependent on us.
That's right.
He dependent on us. Remember, there were slaves and there was the free. And the freedom and slavery only was based on money.
So you saying some of these dudes is free, but they still got they free, but they ain't got that mentality no more.
No, they're not free. They're not free. Because if you was free, you'd open your mouth and say what's up.
That's free, huh?
Huh?
That's being free.
That's free. And free is not just I say it, but I say it to the people that it matters to. Like the white racists in your face. That's who you're supposed to say it to. Yeah. Okay? Our people already know what it is.
Yeah, because white people get a mistake. They get a mistake that you're talking about. That's just like this conversation we having right now. They'll twist that up and say we was being racist, but we two black men speaking from today's society, speaking from
Breonna Taylor's killers just got fuck racism. Call me whatever the fuck you like. There's no courts.
They got off.
That's what Breonna Taylor just showed us. There's no court system. There's no justice. There's nothing. Like, really, abolish the police. People don't want to say that either. I'm with that shit. Abolish them. Not defund. That shit is weak. Abolish them. Get rid of these criminals.
Say defund. Yeah. Yeah.
Why can't we do that? But here's the thing, though. Here's the flip side to it. In order to abolish the police, African Americans are going to have to rise to higher levels of civility. We can't be robbing, shooting, and stealing, and killing one another. Because that's the excuse. That's the excuse they're using right now. Oh, don't look at us shooting this dude 7 times in the back. Oh, you got a homicide problem in Philadelphia. You got a homicide problem over in Chicago. We got to come in and kill all of you. Okay? Matt, you have a homicide problem. Let's deal with your mind. Let's figure out what's bothering you. Let's deal with poverty. Let's deal with lack of education. Let's deal with that. Nah, we ain't dealing with that. You got a homicide problem. Let's get in there with the gat.
It was so good to hear you say that. That Americans here in the black men, black woman in America is the most powerful people in the world.
We are the.
We are
the. There's no.
We moved the crowd, bro.
We moved the whole world, and I've been around the world. I tell you, my G, listen to me. I be in countries they can't even speak English. They're playing our black music in the courts,
in the
restaurants, in the elevators. All of Europe plays black music. They don't play no white shit in Europe, okay? And it's Europe. You can find rock here and there. You can find pop. You can find, but what's blasting is hip-hop and R&B and reggae. That's what Europe wants to see.
That's it, man.
Right now. Same thing with China. Same thing with Saudi Arabia. Same thing with all these countries. Africa, they look at this. I'll give you one last example here. Right when the protests were going on with the police in America, okay, You notice how all the other countries started having problems with their cops. I turn on the TV, I see a protest in England. England has no problem. Okay? England, look, the cops don't even carry guns in England, okay?
No.
Problems. These dudes is like, nah, African Americans out there going through it. They looking at their cops like, oh, fuck you. They like, yo, they having protests.
That's crazy, man.
Wow. See, they're having protests in Australia. Australia is the safest continent on the planet.
Hey, our protest is a culture, huh?
Our protest is, and it inspires other people. It makes them rise up and be like, you know what? Fuck you, too. You gonna get this shit right now.
Hey, man. They don't have no clue. I went out of the country, man, and I asked this dude, I asked the brother straight up, man. I was in Dubai. I asked the brother, I said, man, when you see us over there, when you think about African-American black men, what do you think? He said, man, it looks so dangerous for you guys. He said, it looked like if you just walk out your house, you'll die.
Yeah, and that's the truth.
He's saying, looking from over there to the news and... Yeah. He's like, I mean, we walk around like it ain't nothing, but from their eyes, they like, whoa.
Right.
Damn, they after y'all like that?
Right. Yeah, they are. And they've been like that. 401 years, coming up on 402 years. It's been like that, okay? But this is the point, though. African Americans, like I said, if once we realize that we lead the world, Our little group, look at our little group. We run the NBA, all sports, all music, everything, and we're in the courts, and we're in the government, and we're out of the government. We're in the prisons, too. we're everywhere. We're in religion. We're in the universities. Big up to my man, Michael Eric Dyson.
Michael Shout Eric Dyson.
Dr. Cornell West.
Cornell West.
Big up Skip Gates.
Skip
the
Gates.
The whole PBS thing. These are scholars.
Okay? R.I.P. to Finis Shakur.
Ah, the Queen Mother. Word. And her son. And at the end of the day, look at us, okay? Once we realize who we really are, we wouldn't take nothing from this government. We wouldn't take nothing. But that's the job of a teacher. That's the job of the job of the philosopher.
Somebody's going to walk away. Know. Somebody's going to walk away today, man. You changed their life today, KRS, man. Every time you speak, brother.
Yo, let me tell you this, and I'm going to sound corny right now. But you, you have changed all of our lives.
I love you, man.
Me, Kane, Dougie. We sitting home, my G.
It's going down.
I'm chilling right now in a mansion. Okay,
I am too, man. I'm loving. God is good, man. God is good.
You was right there in Atlanta. I happen to be right there in Atlanta as well. Dougie's in Florida. We coming up.
Everybody keep asking me, how did you get them guys? I'm like, I don't know. I don't know how I fucking got you either. I'm like, hey, you know, God must have been on my side and say, man, I'm going to get the guys for you, Mike.
You know what it is. God is on your side.
Yeah,
man.
I love you, man. I appreciate you, man.
And Africans in America got to realize that God is on our side.
On our side,
God is
man.
On the side of the oppressed. God is on the side of those struggling. That's the side God is on. And the judgment's coming, too, you know.
The judgment is coming too.
Because you can't diss God's people and not have God respond. So look at this COVID. You know, go back and read Moses. Go back and read the 10 plagues that was delivered to Pharaoh. And if you had the blood on your door, the plague passed you by.
Wow.
Go back and read about your history. Moses was a black African, straight up and down, out of Egypt.
Okay? This is a replay we live in, ain't it?
This is a three, four, five replay. We've been here before. We did this already, and we defeated this devil 5 times already.
Damn.
Already. It's just that our people are so used to winning that we just lose. Hmm. We lose because we so used to winning. Every black person.
You win naturally, huh?
We win naturally. without
that's why imagine. Yeah, that's why I was telling my kids, don't be shocked and don't be afraid sometimes, because a lot of times you don't know what people are intimidated or jealous of you by.
Mm-hmm.
And it ain't about material or status.
Right. It's you.
It's what you have naturally.
Right.
They're not gonna tell you what it is.
They can't.
They're just gonna position themselves with power against your insecurity or your natural ability. I'm gonna manipulate his mind so that he don't understand that he has an unnatural ability. That's the only way I can control him.
Right. That is, you just summed up the whole game, because we are immortal. We cannot be destroyed. We're the truth. So if you can't destroy the truth, you have to hide it. And so that's the only way you could deal with the truth. You can't destroy it because it's real.
You gotta hide it.
So you hide it. And how they do it, they hide it in plain sight. They show us our culture everywhere. We just don't see it because we're looking at them. We're looking at what they do. We're looking at what they say. We're looking at how they think. We need to turn inward. Turn inward. What do we think? What do we say?
Yeah.
How do we? And most of us think that we don't matter. Like that Black Lives Matter. That's a deep statement, man. Because even Black folk don't think Black Lives Matter.
I know, man. It's sad.
That's the sad.
It's crazy that you say that, because I have a little success and I've been good. I've been great at what I do, man. And even with my success, sometimes I have to snatch my own collar, man, and say you deserve it.
Right. Wow.
This society make you as a Black man feel like you don't deserve shit.
Right.
And you like, right. why, you know, like, why I don't deserve shit? Like, what did I do personally to anyone to feel like I don't deserve anything, you know? Or I'm not wanted here or welcome to do exactly what it is. If you have an opinion about that, you're violent,
right.
You know?
Right.
You're radical.
Or racist. Or something else.
Yeah.
Anytime you have an opinion, somebody gonna come and judge. But that's why you study. That's why it's important to study.
That's right.
Speak from knowledge. Speak from facts.
That's
speak
right.
From knowledge. Speak with the evidence.
Yeah.
And then everybody, you know, you can have your opinion. You can have your thing. Okay, no problem. But again, we need to go from civil rights to civilization.
To civilization rights. I love that. Civilization rights.
Give me back my nation. Give me back my country.
Yeah.
I'm a sovereign government unto myself. Recognize that. America, the best thing the United States of America can do is, even beyond reparations, beyond that, restore our sovereignty. That's what you got to do. Restore our sovereignty. Give us Mexico. Give us New Mexico. Give us Texas.
Hey man, we never had that in this country, did we?
No, and you're not gonna get it. See, this is philosophy. You pose questions that you know they ain't gonna answer, but it exposes the truth. And the truth is give me sovereignty. You know you took my land, you know you took my government, you know you took my sense of freedom. If you really ain't a colonist no more, give me back my stuff. Now, nah, I can't give you back your stuff.
Yeah.
I can't do it. Oh, so you still gonna keep me in this bondage then? And now that we got the internet and the world is a little more closed, like, you know, people can see shit and see what's going on. Oh no, it's African Americans' time right now.
Yes,
this
it is.
The time to stand up.
That's
stand
right.
Up right now for yourself, for your
That's
children,
right.
for your
family. It's a great time. It's a great time, man. Ice
a great
Cube.
Time.
I was talking to Ice Cube. Ice Cube was saying the same thing. He was like, don't let up, man, you know, because, man, you know, they built this country off our backs, man. They built this whole thing off our back. And, you know, it's time for us to be strong, man, but not to hold you, man. I love you, big brother. You are a blessing to the culture. You are a blessing to hip hop. When they see you performing on October the 9th with Big Daddy Kane,
I felt good about that shit.
Oh, you. Yo. They're going to go crazy.
Yo, I wish I could take that show with me on the road.
Hey, you got me too. I'm like, Michael, okay. We got to do that. We got to do it when we come back, when the people come
back. You know what? Real talk.
We got to do that, man.
Real talk. We got to get somebody like Budweiser or some shit.
Hennessy, to sponsor that.
Sponsor that shit, because I'm telling you. And look, before we go, people out there, listen to me. I'm not trying to sell a show. I'm not trying to.
Yeah, this shit is crazy. You.
The show was dope. I have not been part of something that exciting in years.
Oh, man, thank you, man.
I left out of there feeling good. I left out of there feeling good.
Thank you,
man. And everyone else's performance. I tell you, I saw Rakim's performance. He ripped it. I've seen Rakim 100 times.
Oh, my God.
For some reason, he was in his element right there.
All you guys was. And you know what? You know what? I could say this, man, but the game don't pay you guys enough homage, man.
Yo.
They don't pay you guys enough homage. And when they do pay y'all homage, they forget for another 10, 15, 20 years. We gotta keep that. Hey man, you guys are looking good. You're healthy. Word. You're strong. You're performing just as well as any. I mean, you got more wind than these young. I seen when these young dudes perform, they ain't even bringing it like that. They up there belly drinking lean, you know what I mean?
They do that.
Hey, man.
There's a discipline to this. There is a discipline to this.
It's a discipline, man. If you could say, well, before we get out of here, if you could say one thing to a rap artist, what one advice would you give them?
To a rap artist?
To any young black man that's aspiring to be great at what he do.
Yo. The one advice I would give you is to be a continuation of your ancestry. Most people get into the industry and they by themselves, they cut off the future and they cut off the past so that they can have an identity. And that's understandable. Mm. But if you new and just coming up and you want to last for a long time, you want to have value for a long time, then you have to connect yourself with timeless principles and people.
Connect yourself with timeless people.
People
and principles.
Love, timeless. Forgiveness, timeless. Mercy, understanding.
Those charity, are timeless.
Timeless. These are timeless. If you conduct yourself with charity, with knowledge, with understanding, with wisdom, with love, okay? You'll last anything. You'll blast through anything. And I'm speaking from experience. You'll last through anything. Love is the greatest shield against everything. Even in battle, love your enemies.
Love
will kill you faster than you know how many brothers dying out here for the love?
For the love, man. Come on, man. That's why I gotta play it on the way out the door. That's why I gotta play it on the way. I gotta play it. I gotta play it one time, man. Let me play it one time with you.
Love is a weapon.
Let me play.
Love is a weapon. Keep it near you all the time.
Huh? That love is, ain't it, man?
I said, yeah, word. That's what it is. And so is peace. You know what I'm saying? Peace is not won at the end. Peace is started at the beginning. You don't have a career unless you have peace.
You don't.
So to that youngin' out there listening to us, I'll just say, have confidence in yourself, never doubt, brush up on your skills, and connect yourself to timeless principles and people.
Love you, brother. Thank you so much, man. Thank you for the knowledge. Thank you for the wisdom. And thank you for the book. Y'all go get KRS's book. I'm telling you, it's a must read. Make sure y'all check us out October the 9th. On hiphoplegends.com. Man, we love you, KRS.
I love you.
Man. I love you, man.
No
doubt. All right. This love, baby. I got to end them on this.
Well, I love my tailor. I'm in love with that girl over there. So, all the people out there that fall in love with the material items, we're going to bump the feet a little something like
that. Let them hear.
I'm in junior high with a B plus grade. At the end of the day, I don't care. From school to my mom's apartment. I gotta tell my suckers every day I'm starting. To wear out if you soft your mark. To stay on course means to roll with force. A boy named Rob is chilling in a bed in front of my building with the rest of his friends. I give him a pound. Oh, I mean, I take his hand. He's the neighborhood drug killer. My man, I go upstairs and hug my mother. Kiss my kid.
I love you, man. Thank you, man.
Yeah.